sings my soul, my Savior God.
Thank you for the invitation to say a few words. Before we get going, Robin is going to share a prayer. There will be one more song, then I'll share a few thoughts. Then we'll have the military salute. So this time I'll turn it over to Robin.
I want to say that I thank you so very much for allowing us to be a part of your family. It's been a privilege. Probably 30 years for sure. I met Gerald and Liz when Brittany was 3 years old. And they never left my life but my mom. And so not only have they impacted your life, but they also impacted our life and always included us as a joy and sharing so many wonderful things together. Not only in the miracles of people's lives being spared. I can remember when Jessica and Cole was in the house and the gun went off and God spared her life. And there's so many other things that have flooded my mind this morning of seeing God's hand on someone's life. And so I want to say that I can truly say that the favor of God is on all of your family and that he has showed so much kindness and mercy. So I'd like to open in prayer and ask the Lord to comfort our hearts, and when we're together at different times now, that you'll be able to rejoice, that your joy may be better, and that your sorrow will be lighter, and that each time that you're together, that we'll consider each other's life so precious to one another. So let's pray today. Dear Holy God, we thank you so very much for allowing us to have the privilege and the opportunity to be together on this earth. And we know, God, that you have a heavenly home for us. And this day we come in that confidence that one day we will see one another again. We thank you for the stories and the memories that we will be able to share with one another to keep our hearts close. And today I'm asking for the comforting peace to rest upon each household, that even though we are in separate places at so many different dynamics in this day and time that we are living, you said that love covers the multitude of sin and love never fails, and that you bind us together with cords that cannot be broken. And I'm asking for that to be tighter around us this day and forevermore. In Jesus' most lovely name, amen.
On a hill far away stood an old rugged cross, the emblem of suffering and shame. And I love that old cross where the dearest and best for a world of lost sinners was slain. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down.
Him, we loved him. He was truly a man of honor. And as I was preparing for Gerald's short eulogy, my mind went to 2 Samuel chapter 3, verse number 38. I've been doing this for nearly 40 years, and this is only the second time I've used this verse at a memorial service. And I only use it for those who truly deserving of this particular verse. 2 Samuel 3:38. Do you not realize that a prince and a great man has fallen in Israel today? That's how I see him. A great man. A wonderful man. Truly a special person who is special to so many. And I know that we only have a few moments here in this setting, and I'm cold and you're probably cold, so I'll be brief. He deserves a grand exit. He really does. But maybe this is fitting for Gerald's life. A man who would buy, 100 acres and build in the back of it. I guess he kind of just wants to be left alone back there. I don't know. But let me share just a few of my thoughts of why I think he was so special. I think, first of all, he was a frugal man, yet he was incredibly generous. Gerald was a giving person, and not just with money, but with his home, with his land, with his time. Multiple times we went out to the property and we held our church picnics there, and they were so gracious not only to prepare but to host. we would just spend hours and hours and hours in fellowship and time with one another, so generous in kindness, in the words that they spoke, and how did they literally, how he spoke into people's lives. I don't think Gerald always talked at people. He talked into people. There's a difference. And I always appreciated that. You know, there was a time when our church was in a crisis situation. We had to get a short-term loan in order to save our building. And we were not able to get it as a church because of not enough equity. And Gerald got that loan in his own name, a two-month loan. And we had made statements and signatures that we would pay him the interest for those 2 months, and we paid him back in those 2 months, and he was like, no interest, we're good. Yeah, you know, just a wonderful gift to our church he was. Secondly, he was a Christian man without being self-righteous. Like Jesus, he was full of grace and truth, and lots of stories. Gerald, oh my gosh, the stories he told. In all the years that I knew him, and he was masterful at sharing stories. And I heard him, you know, not the same ones, but he would tell me 1,000 stories and not repeat himself. And everyone was intriguing. Everyone was different. Everyone had a lesson attached to it. He knew how to take a story and apply it to a situation. And he did it time and again and again. Like all of us, Gerald made his mistakes. You know, he had his situations, but what I found about him is that he was always quick to make restitution, always quick to fix whatever it was that was broken. I appreciated him. You know, my daughter said, she said, please make sure you say this, so I'm going to say it. Gerald once told her that he repeated something that Liz said on their first date together. Evidently, Liz said, you know, having coffee with one another is an intimate thing. And so my daughter and Gerald, every Sunday morning before church, would have coffee together. Well, my daughter hates coffee. She said she would choke it down just to respect his life and what Sister Liz had said to him. Third thought I had was, he's a great family man, but he gave his family freedom. Gerald was proud of every one of you. Very proud. I know that because he talked to me about every one of you. He mentioned every one of your names on an ongoing basis. He was proud of his family, proud of his children. I enjoyed every moment and embraced his presence. What an incredible, incredible man. And one other quality that made Gerald a prince and a great man is that he was an excellent leader by being a humble servant. I had the privilege of Gerald serving on the pastor's council, sat in a lot of meetings with him. In fact, at one time, him and Liz sat on the council together. And somebody challenged Liz during that meeting, and Gerald stepped up to protect her. And Liz said, Gerald, I can handle myself. But he was so insightful, so full of wisdom. He would bring to the table something that nobody else presented. In all the years of serving in this capacity, I've never had anyone serve with me that had the same personality, the same depth of understanding, the same ability to look at situations from a unique way as Brother Gerald. To this day, hundreds of people who have served on the council with me, none like him, unique in every way. Man, I miss him. I just miss his presence and everything that he brought to the table. What an incredible man. You know, he wasn't too proud to do the dirty work or serve in the most menial tasks. No matter what the job was that was given to him from our church or our council, he did it with everything he had. I just remember all those moments of walking the property with him, looking at the roses, enjoying everything he had built with his hands. I remember standing in his house, looking out the window with all those trees out there, and him telling me bit by bit how he had put it all together. I mean, I could talk for hours about Brother Gerald and what he brought to the table and how he spoke into my life. I am who I am today because of the investment he made in me. And I so appreciate him for all of that. Here's the thing. Jesus said, the greatest among you will be the servant of all. Let me close with this. 2 Corinthians 5:8 says to be away from the body is to be present with the Lord. I am confident. I am persuaded based upon Scripture that Gerald is in heaven. And I don't sorrow as those who have no hope. I'm honored to have been invited to speak today so that you would realize that a prince and a great man is here before us today. Thank you.
Bad morning when this life is over, I'll fly away to a home on God's celestial shore. I'll fly away.
Jail Tan Tuck. Port Hearns. Ready. Aim. Fire. Aim. Fire. Aim. Fire.